see the content of the talk, and the talk is related to Pomerantchuk, because he was the first who proposed an idea that paramagnetic insulators may have fermionic quasi-particles. And that was the origin of a very deep and today very broad range field of research. So next I will tell a few words about second conjecture made 30 years later by Bill Anderson. And then I will present some number of relevant experiments last year. And finally, I will say a few words about theoretical approaches developed in last few years. So, this is an extraction from the paper published in 2021. Where it was said that a number of experimental data suggests the fermionic nature of excitations in insulators which seem to be paramagnetic down to very low temperature. Later on, they found that most of these materials actually become ordered in this or a bit way, but nevertheless, now we know that there are several classes of insulators, magnetic insulators, which has rather strong exchange interactions and do not show any usual order parameters at lowest measurable temperatures. Actually, there was even before Pomerantchuk was some very important theoretical paper by Jürgen and Wigner, who considered a one-dimensional chain of spin 1/2 system and demonstrated by explicit transformation that the Hamiltonian of this system can be reduced to three fermions. This transformation is shown here, but actually this Hamiltonian is explicitly transformed to the form which contains only Hopping terms of fermions. And in this sense, there could be a relation between Pomerantchuk conjecture and this result, but I don't know was it any relation or not, but what is important that up to a relatively recent period of last 20 or 30 years, usually people consider three-dimensional systems. And this specific feature of one-dimensional model probably was not considered as something relevant. However, probably it is. So let's go later on in time by large steps. Next important step in the same direction was made by Anderson in 1973-74, who discussed a possible exact possible ground state of frustrated two-dimensional anti-ferromagnet. Let's say you have a triangular lattice of spins, they interact anti-ferromagnetically, and so it is not obvious what kind of ordered state they produce because of frustration. And the hypothesis of Anderson was that in this case, there is no name for the parameter, there is no any breaking of rotational symmetry in the spin space. But still, we need to find some wave function for the ground state. And the hypothesis was that this the system choose the following type of the ground state, which was called resonant valence bonds. So consider two spins here and here. If it would be only this pair of spins and they interact anti-ferromagnetically, so the ground state of this system of two spins would be a singlet, like this. Now, one would put these singlet states here for these two sides, and here, and here. But then there are also interactions between these points. Interactions are identical between all nearest neighbors. So the idea was that one should try to write down a wave function as a sum over all possible distribution of singlets over the latest. Well, again, this was very influential idea. It doesn't seem that it was correct idea for triangular antiferromagnet, but later people found that this kind of ground space indeed can be realized in a little bit more complicated systems. Next step, which makes discussion of this frustrated antiferromagnets and valence bonds to be very hot subject, is a paper again of Anderson of 87 related to the discovery of atomic superconductors and attempts to describe the origin of this phenomenon. And since these materials, without talking like in this form, present very strong antiferromagnetic interaction, it was proposed that current state, say, this material is of this resonance valence bond state, and then it was an infinite number of speculations and sometimes even theories tried to explain features of IPC materials in terms of this approach. This is still not finished. One of the ideas developed almost at the same time belongs to Zelazinsky, Polyakov, and Bigman, who are trying to develop an idea of Pomeranchuk and to show that in a antiferro in a system the antiferromagnetic interaction, which is not, however, really named antiferromagnet, because of quantum fluctuations, that in this system one can find quasi particles with fermionic statistics. The idea was that in a two-dimensional system with full symmetry in the spin space, so there is all free symmetry, there are specific topological excitations called skirmions, which they were non-zero Hopf invariant. Simply speaking, these are excitations like this. You have a spin up somewhere in the center, a spin down at infinity, a very large circle, and then there is some rotation spins down. For isotropic two-dimensional magnet, there is an explicit solution for this topological excitation, And the idea proposed by Zalashinsky, Polyakov, and Pinkman was that such excitation may have fermionic exchange statistics. Unfortunately, real proof of this statement did not appear. There was several attempts to derive this fermionic features of fermions, but it seems to me that still it was not done. Next, I would like to mention a few papers of Lev Yov and Anatoly Larkin. It is about the same time. They, in the first paper, they try to really derive these fermionic statistics in a well-defined model of two-dimensional anti-fermionic with large speed. The hope was that for half integer value of spin, we could find some kind of periphase which leads to this fermionic statistics. But we didn't find. Also, they developed another approach to the same problem, how to find fermions in the anti-fermion in this paper. And here the approach was more close to the one of Anderson, which I will try to describe very briefly the following way. It is known that spin 1/2 can be represented as bilinear combination of three Majorana things. Like this, or a invariant way, or in components like this. Now, Hamiltonian is a bilinear in spin operators. This bilinear in spin term of Hamiltonian means that this Hamiltonian is quart in terms of Majorana operators. Now imagine that for some reason we are allowed to replace pair of these Majoranas by some average value like this. Like it is done in the usual mean field type approach. Then if it is possible to do like this, the rest of the Hamiltonian becomes also quadratic in our Majorana fields and can be diagonalized and studied to a great detail. The major problem is why. Why we are allowed to make this mean field like approximation and to decouple this quart terms. It is rather difficult to come up with a model which allows this approximation, but still some versions of this approach was considered in the paper mentioned in this one, and in many other papers at this period. So you see important in the relation with my main subject is that if for some reason we have a model which allows such a decoupling, then fermionic excitations appear quite naturally from the model which originally contains only localized spin 1/2. A bit later I will show that indeed now we know for sure some relatively complicated spin models which indeed lead to the fermionic excitations. But before I come to this point, let me first discuss what are different kinds of spin liquid which principle could exist. This is the latest, if one half spins. What we may have? We may have usual name order. In other words, we may have valence bond state there for some reason, translational invariance is broken, and these peak lines denote positions of dimers or singlets made out of two spins. So here, these two spins are in the singlet state, and these two spins are in the singlet state. There are some situations where indeed such valence bond solid realizes the ground state. And this is not liquid, of course. This is a state without breaking of spin rotation symmetry, but it's a state, the broken translation symmetry. Because we see here some super lattice on the top of original lattice of space. Spin liquids are some other kind of states there. We suppose that no symmetry is broken. Not a translational symmetry, not a spin rotation symmetry. And people discuss three different kinds of this ground state, depending on the properties of the low energy excitations. First one is a spin liquid with a depth to lowest excitation, no, with no gapless quasi-particles, and these states necessarily create some interesting feature that the degeneracy of the ground state depends on the topology of the lattice. That means that if our lattice is defined with periodic boundary conditions, say like this, as a cylinder, then we expect a degeneracy, double degeneracy for the ground state. If it is periodic in both directions, like this and like this, so lattice is on torus, then degeneracy will be four. Why there is such a degeneracy? Well, there is a nice theorem which was formulated, probably it was some simpler version of this theorem formulated even before, but here present up several relatively recent references, where it was shown that if we have a system with a depth, non-zero energy depth to excitations, and it has no breaking of translational symmetry, then where should be degeneracy dependent on topology. Next kind of spin liquids. These are spin liquids called critical, and the meaning of it is that there are several locations in the Brillouin zone, several points in K space, where excitation energy is zero. Usually, it means that spectrum near this point is Dirac-like, linear dependence energy on momentum near each of these points. And so we should expect power law correlations of spins in a space or a time direction in the infrared. such as, state the excitations are gambles on the whole line. Line the surface, but we don't know any examples of three-dimensional materials with such properties, but there are some two-dimensional ones. So this is why I discuss it as a circle in the, instead of the surface. And there is that at least one of materials with a rather complicated structure.
What is that? That is a dependent for part of it.
Ah, sorry. F is, sorry, I forgot to put it on slide. There are, in all this material studied, you may find the basic energy scale exchange, the strength of exchange coupling between nearest spins. It can be extracted from high temperature measurements. So, usually it is this J of the order of hundreds Kelvin. So this is something like 3 to 100. Now people start to cool down the sample and measure magnetization, susceptibility, and so on, and look for the for some phase transition, for appearance of some low temperature state. And in this material, on, in some other similar ones, there is nothing, no phase transition up to temperatures 10 times below J, 20 times, 100 times. This material is, this F is just a ratio of this basic energy scale to the temperature that people could cool down and did not see any phase transition. So in some sense it is a measure of how this material is really, how strong it is really. There are some approximate theoretical approximate theories which propose that in order to get such a state with a zero excitation energy of the whole line, you need to add to the usual nearest neighbor Heisenberg Hamiltonian some terms which condense multi-particle exchange terms. Not just pairwise exchange, but three particle, four particle. So, and it says it is indeed a correct conjecture. Okay, the major problem on the theoretical side is that first, example, it is a one-dimensional spin 1/2 centimeter length, or a, but of course it is a three-dimensional sample, but spins in this material form chains.
No gap.
No gap.
No gap.
This is this material is composed of the chains of spin 1/2 coupled relatively strongly inside chains and with very weak coupling between chains. So with good approximation it can be considered as a collection of one-dimensional systems.
Миш, что по осям?
This is a result of neutron scattering.
По оси абсцисс что?
По оси, well.
Энергия или момент?
Momentum, momentum. This is a momentum, transport momentum. This is a density. And different set of data and corresponding curves correspond to different applied magnetic field. What is seen here is that when magnetic field is applied, you see that a reappearance of satellite piece, both positions move more or less linear with applied field. This is exactly what was predicted by the theory developed for this one-dimensional problem. Here we can look again at the Jordan-Wigner transformation. I wrote it here in a simplified way without interaction of Z component of spins, but the essence of the story is seen here as well. Magnetic field coupled to the component of spin after transformation to fermions corresponds to the chemical potential of these fermions. So what you find is that parabolic dispersion of fermions give a chemical potential proportional to the external magnetic field. And so the
virtual lines.
So this is a dispersion of our fermions, and the chemical potential for these fermions is proportional to magnetic field, and so the wave vector of these fermions grows the magnetic field, and this is what we saw in the scattering. Okay, now what happens in 2D? The most ideal two-dimensional anti-ferromagnetic crystal known to date is called like this. Here it is a photo of the crystal. And this is a structure of relevant to a magnetic problem. Spins correspond to this copper ions and sitting in the sides of the two-dimensional Kagoma lattice. These are Kagoma layers. And again, interaction between layers is very weak, and the first approximation can be neglected. Here you see a measurement of magnetic susceptibility as function of temperature. This is inverse susceptibility. So what this is, that it goes like in a usual antiferromagnet at high temperatures. Then there is some additional growth of sticky. So high minus one goes to zero, but not to zero actually. At lowest temperatures, susceptibility is still finite, and no long range order is detected in this. This Kagoma lattice with anti-ferromagnetic coupling is even more frustrated than triangular lattice. And recently was a paper, experimental paper for dead people made a Newton scattering study of the same material. Yeah. And found intensity distribution, or here it is, color shows intensity of scattering in a, and this axis corresponds to wave vector in the Brillouin zone. Roughly speaking, what we found is that there is nothing apart from very short range order. There are correlation of spins on nearest sides and nothing more. No, not a long range order, not even an attempt long range. So it looks like a spin loop. And there is another material, also with Kagoma structure, called like this, Capella sun. What we know else about such a system? Well, again, the real analytical theory is that there is quite a number of numerical research on this kind of system. For example, here in this paper, they did a direct diagonalization of the Heisenberg Hamiltonian on Kagoma lattice. And one of the most interesting features which was found is the following. Since we did the exact diagonalization, we could classify excitations by speed. And we found that excitations give a spin 1, so the states which have if spin different by 1 from the ground state, we have a gap. This is a gap. But there is a lot of other excitations which belongs to the same spin as a ground state. This excitation exists. They deal with some range of energies. Approximately the density of this excitation is quadratic. The nature of this excitation is unknown.
Can you explain? Here we see gapless excitation. It's enough to tell that we have to eliminate.
Well, no. It's not enough. We might have gapless excitations in anti-ferromagnets, for example.
But what is necessary to see that water? It's I see liquid, but not what?
Well, if you don't see any kind of long-range order, you try to find some magnetization, some staggered magnetization, some breaking of translational symmetry. If you don't see, then if you don't see anything of this, then well, you have this, some kind of liquid.
It's necessary to have only gapless.
No, this is. Because I can give you a counter example. Gapless excitation exists in a usual ferromagnet or antiferromagnet. Just magnons. They are gapless.
This is not usual magnons. This is Jordan-Wigner excitation. This is front.
Yes, of course, but it was a question. If it is sufficient to find gapless excitations for to qualify. justify the system as a spin leak? My answer is not. It is not sufficient. But here it is the importance of this observation of Kepler's singlet excitations. It is not purely theoretical, zodiac feature. I think that it is related to experiment on these materials which I mentioned already. And but let me first present you some other examples. This is an example of spin 1/2 triangular antiferromagnet. Again, what you see here is spin susceptibility, which has almost no structure from 100 kelvins to 1 kelvin. It is still paramagnetic. It is, I'm not sure that we know what is the nature of this strange ground state. Finally, even more exotic example, you will see why it makes sense to look at this structure. There is a real material known for quite a long time, green diapause. This is the structure of magnetic ions. It is composed of triangles which are organized into honeycomb lattice. There is some coupling inside triangle and some other coupling between triangles. I knew about such a subject latest just by some purely theoretical consideration, and it was a surprise that such a thing exists in nature. Yes, it exists. And it looks like blue green. Moreover, it was for some reason relatively long ago a study of Heisenberg antiferromagnet model defined on this lattice, and some interesting quantum phase transition was found. You will see in a minute why it is interesting to know that such lattice exists. But before let me mention some rather general problem which makes analysis of data and development of theory of these materials quite complicated. Herbert Smith, this very nice Kagomery system. But it has intrinsic defects, substitution of zinc by copper. And vice versa. As a result, some percents of copper ions appear to be between Kagoma plates and very weakly coupled to the rest. There are not many of them, but still some 2-3%. Then Mills measure motorization or specific heat at very low temperatures, we got a quite important contribution of some unknown origin. It was, for example, detected in this way. First idea was that this additional contribution is related just with this free speed. But they tried to feed the low temperature data, they were a brilliant function for free spins. It doesn't work. So, how one can understand us. But my hypothesis is that what happens is that these three beings, they're not quite free, but they interact with a continuum of singlet excitations which exist in this Kabbalah plane. And as a result, we have some kind of paramagnetic spins dressed by interaction with gapless excitations in the planes. But this is just fantasy. Nothing really is done in this direction. Another complication is that when people tell about some material with a triangular lattice and Heisenberg Hamiltonian, it is triangular to usually to some accuracy, rather close to triangular, but still there is some weak connection. And these spin liquids, they are very fragile. The ground state may be changed quite significantly if you add some liquid mixture. How much time?
3 minutes.
Uh-huh. Now I come to the model proposed by Alexei Gitaev for completely different reason, and which becomes very influential in different directions of theoretical mathematical physics. Hamiltonian is written here. It is anisotropic. You see, there are terms which contain only x component of spins. These spins are sitting in conical lattice. And there are three types of bonds. For example, this type corresponds to x coupling. These bonds correspond to y coupling, and this one to z coupling. This Hamiltonian is exactly solvable. It is rather easy to see that it contains infinite number of integrals of motion. All of them can be expressed as such a cyclic product of six spin operators along hexagonal plane. And the product of such six operators for any plane is commuting with the Hamiltonian. So, actually, this is a model which realizes a two-dimensional generalization of the Jordan-Wigner trick. It can be reduced to three fermions by about the same way. It can be done in different ways. For example, originally Alexei did it as follows. He associated four Majorana operators with each side of the lattice. Here we denote it as C, and then Vx, Vy, Vz. Then we may define operators like here. These sigma tilde operators have the same commutation relations as Markov operator. And what you need is to choose some appropriate subspace, because here there are too many degrees of freedom due to some discrete gauge invariance. You need to fix the gauge, and after that you have an exact representation of this Hamiltonian in terms of Majorana operators. The same can be understood as a generalization of Jordan-Wigner. But well, probably this I will skip since time is going a bit fast. So what happens, what we see after we reduce the problem to three fermions? Now we have this Hamiltonian, quadratic and Majorana operators. And for Actually, this transformation can be done for arbitrary distribution of coupling constant, even non-uniform in space. But if we consider first the simplest situation with uniform distribution of coupling J, then we can diagonalize the problem in a Fourier space, and the result is the following. This is of diagonal matrix in Fourier space. FQ is this combination of couplings, and if couplings are nearly equal, better to say if these couplings are here inside this triangle. This triangle is defined according to this strength of coupling in different dimensions. So it is sufficient to look here in the middle. Here all couplings are equal, and in this case our fermions have just single point, their energy is zero. In my Rana presentation there are two points like this, they're symmetric, but if we make Dirac field out of Majorana fields, then we will find that this is just a single point. So this is a spectrum of excitation. So Kitaev model realizes at least one type of spin liquids, namely critical spin liquids. Actually, some extension of this model were constructed, and they cover all possible kinds of spin liquids. And this is, for example, the same kind of model proposed by Yao and Kivilson. Here you see this free 12 or green dust lattice, where we can apply the same trick as originally made by Kitaev, and we find that in some range of parameters this model localizes a gapful topological spin liquid. Now let me skip most of the rest and mention a very recent development due to partially the same authors. We're able to generalize the Kitaev approach to a model with isotropic exchange in the spin space. I think that may lead to a very interesting development of theory of spin liquids. Thank you.
Do you want to complete something? Because it's there are so many different information.
Yes, the conclusion is very short.
Okay. Understand something very basic. Usual magnons are Goldstone bosons appearing due to spontaneous breaking of rotational symmetry, right? To have something fermion which is massless, the only way I can think of is spontaneous breaking of supersymmetry. I cannot imagine any other mechanism to have massless fermionic collective excitation. Do you have supersymmetry in your model? How can that possible then?
Well, I just present some versions of how it can be possible. For example, well, concerning well, original ideas which I mentioned were not supported by a real theory, but at the end I think I demonstrated a model which indeed has fermionic excitations in spite of the absence of any supersymmetry in the beginning. Or at least this supersymmetry is not evident.
Supersymmetry is double degeneracy of all excited levels of Hamiltonian. Do you have it there? That's what supersymmetry is.
That might be.
But this is supersymmetry then.
Okay, you are given a Hamiltonian. If you can prove that this Hamiltonian has in any sense a supersymmetry, it would be rather interesting. It is not known about Kitaev Hamiltonian. I have not seen any discussion of supersymmetry in relation with this Hamiltonian.
I see it for the first time, and of course I also don't know, but if you claim that the excitations is massless, there should be some symmetry behind. For bosonic excitations, we know that either it's gauge particles, like photons are massless due to gauge symmetry, or they are Goldstone bosons. If it's fermionic, then you should have supersymmetry, and then it's either Goldsteiners, which appear due to spontaneous breaking of supersymmetry, or just fermionic partners of gauge bosons, for example, Greeners. And I can't imagine of anything else.
Could I ask you to continue it maybe just after discussion? It's interesting, but nevertheless. So, are there any questions? Thank you. Last talk of this session. Yes, Professor Gignier, Institute of Theoretical Physics, Landau Institute. Pani Rańczuk, instabilities.